stewardess said that both pilots.
Can you fly this plane and land it?
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley.
A scene from one of the funniest movies ever made, Airplane, premiering in 1980, still makes me laugh and legions of fans laugh out loud more than four decades later. But would the push-the-envelope humor that made Airplane funny ever make it into a major studio film today?
Joey, you like movies about gladiators?
Sorry, I don't understand.
Cutty say can't hang.
Oh, stewardess, I speak jive.
Oh, good.
Johnny, what can you make out of this?
This? Well, I can make a cap, or a brooch, or a pterodactyl.
Airplane made fun of everyone, but it did it with love, and audiences loved the movie. It remains one of the top-ranked comedies of all time. It grossed more than $200 million in sales from a movie made on a budget of just $3.5 million. And now the true story of Airplane, as told by the guys who made the film. Its three directors, David Zucker, Jim Abrams, and Jerry Zucker, can be found in the book, Surely You Can't Be Serious. And I am beyond serious and delighted to welcome David Zucker to Frank Buckley Interviews. David, thank you for, as I said to you earlier, the decades of laughter that you have provided to me and to the many audiences from your film.
Well, it's our pleasure, and you know we had fun doing it, obviously. So,
thank you.
Yeah, it made us laugh.
Let me start with where I with the question that I just asked at the top there, the humor that really sort of got to us. Some of it was very edgy, and went after. It really went after everyone in one way or another. Would that film get made today?
Oh, yeah, of course, just without the jokes. But you know, we've shown it to audiences. You know, we have screenings of Airplane all the time, and for years, and the audiences laugh all the way through, just as much as they laughed 43 years ago. However, if we were to go to the studio boardroom, the executive offices of the studios, they would say, wait a minute, you have a pilot coming on to a little kid, you have subtitles for black people. I mean, they would probably never greenlight this.
Right. I think audiences then maybe were more open to it. Maybe we understood that the filmmakers behind it were not being malicious.
I think it still comes through. We're not being malicious. We're just parodying, you know, those airline disaster movies, which, you know, for 10 years they played nonstop.
Right.
And finally we said, you know, hey, the emperor has no clothes.
Right. When you went to the studio with this script, first of all, Paramount loved it. Michael Eisner loved it.
Right.
Jeffrey Katzenberg was ready to go with it. But you went in, and did they want to futz with that script right away?
Yes, they did. And we were very apprehensive about it. They assigned a guy from the studio staff, the production staff, to take us through a rewrite. And that's when we did the flashbacks. You know, Paramount wanted to develop the love story, and we were fine with it as long as we could make more jokes. So it was fine. So we did the beach scene, the John Travolta scene, all those flashbacks that we did.
Yeah. The lead male actors that you have cast, Leslie Nielsen, Peter Graves, Lloyd Bridges, Robert Stack. This was a murderer's row of dramatic actors,
right.
Great serious actors.
We didn't want any sense of humor at all from the actors.
How did you make that clear to them? I mean, first of all, three directors, that's very strange as well at the time, and or even now, I guess. But how do you then communicate that to these incredibly dramatic actors? Look, play it straight.
Yeah, we did a table read early on, and we said, we don't want you to play it straight. We want you to play it as though you don't know you're in a comedy. And that really, I think that resonated with them. And the only one who kind of took a while to get it was Lloyd Bridges, who was trying to make sense out of his dialogue.
Right.
Always a mistake with our scripts. So, but, you know, and he was wondering what my character would say, this or that. So Stack comes onto the set and says, Lloyd, there's spears going into the wall and watermelons falling behind us. Just keep talking. Nobody's listening to us. And so he was fine after that.
Some of the actors who did not make the cut, Sigourney Weaver, Shelley Long, David Letterman, take us, and you do in the book, but take us into their auditions.
Well, Sigourney Weaver came in. We did New York casting. She came in dressed to the nines as a 1940s stewardess. And she was very good, but she didn't want to say a few of the lines. Like, I remember how I used to sit on your face and wriggle. So that was, we said, okay, that's good to know. And so, and Shelley Long came in. She was very good. But somehow when Julie Haggerty came in, that's what made us laugh out loud. It was just, she is that character. That's the way she is. She's the sweetest person on the planet.
Yeah, you guys talk about the fact that you all just fell in love with her.
Right, immediately. Yeah. And the same thing happened with Robert Hayes when he came in. Oh, okay, this is the guy.
And David Letterman kept saying to you, I can't act,
right? No,
I can't act.
Yeah, David, we were fans of his from the Comedy Store. We would go there all the time. We got to know him a little bit. And we got him to come in to read. And he did, but he wasn't interested really in doing the thing. And so I think we wanted him to come in and screen test. So he came in and screened. He just kept saying, I'm not an actor. And he says in the book, he loved the movie and he loved it even more because he wasn't in it. So it was fine.
And one of you said to him after the audition, yeah, you're right.
That you're right. I can't remember who that was. Let's say it was me.
Back to this idea of three directors. In this medium where it's so much about the director's vision,
right,
when you have three incredibly creative guys, how did that work?
Well, we always worked as a team. It was an equal partnership. Like when we wrote, I would write the jokes, Jim would type, and Jerry would bring coffee. So it was like completely equal. But most of the work is done before you get to the set. So it's the writing, casting, sets, costumes. When we get onto the set, we're just so used to working together. And Jerry was the one who talked to the actors because the Directors Guild insisted on only one person can talk to the actor. They even sent a union guy to the set to make sure that, the other ones didn't talk. But we ended up, when the union goon was not there, we all would talk. The actors were very comfortable with us, and
right,
we didn't pretend that we knew how to direct anyway. So they were, and the crew was very helpful, the camera people, and what we didn't know, we learned.
Right, but and let me ask you about that. You're young guys from Wisconsin, you're in Hollywood, you'd had some success already.
Right.
But you're directing these huge stars.
Yeah, well, that was, it was amazing. I mean, because
were you nervous? Did you think?
No.
Were there any moments where you thought, what the heck are we doing here?
No, I think we were, part of the thing that where we loaded up a U-Haul truck and left Milwaukee for Hollywood, and we had stars in our eyes, and we thought maybe, we'd be a performing group, and we would direct, and we would make movies, and we never thought about the odds, so I don't think we were ever scared because we were so self-confident. May have come out of just being completely naive.
Right, right.
But we knew we had the goods.
One of your casting choices was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Right.
Ultimately, but he was not the first role.
No, we first, and I don't know why we didn't think of him first, but a lot of our mistakes were magically corrected by the universe. So we went to Pete Rose, and fortunately, really, there was baseball season when we were shooting, so he couldn't do it. And so Kareem was our second choice. We got, we went to him.
And there was another athlete who auditioned, Bruce Jenner.
Came in. He auditioned for Stryker, for the Bob Hayes. And so someone was pushing it. I don't know if it was somebody from the studio or someone who knew our executive producer, Howard Koch, but he came in three times to read, the first two times for Stryker, the third time for Elaine. So
we didn't know. That's not a line.
No, that's a line.
Oh, okay. I was going to say.
It's in the book. It's all showbiz.
All right. On that note, we are going to take a short break. Coming up, how has the industry changed? And what jokes will always get a laugh? We'll be right back with that.
Every passenger on this plane who had fish for dinner will become violently ill in the next half hour.
Just how serious is it, Doctor?
Extremely serious. Starts with a slight fever, dryness of the throat. As the virus penetrates the red blood cells, the victim becomes dizzy. Begins to experience an itching, a rash. From there, the poison goes to work on the central nervous system, causing severe muscle spasms, followed by the inevitable drooling. At this point, the entire digestive system collapses, accompanied by uncontrollable flatulence, until finally the poor bastard is reduced to
a scene again from one of the funniest movies in the history of movies, Airplane. We are here with one of its directors, David Zucker. We heard flatulence in that scene, and you referenced that sort of humor in Leslie Nielsen's eulogy. And it occurred to me that in some ways, fart jokes were something that you guys had in common.
Well, Leslie was kind of a closet clown. He had a whole career full of these deadly serious roles.
Yeah.
And we assumed, we didn't care if he had a sense of humor. He just had to be serious and be himself. But it turned out, you know, he loved to carry this little diaphragm around where he would make fart sounds. And he said he would do it while Bob or Julie's, you know, were doing their straight lines and try to crack them up. Sold these things to all the crew. Finally, the assistant director had to say, all right, these are banned from the set. You can't do that. And every time when Leslie would go on a talk show, he would have this fart machine. So that's, he was a prankster.
And is that, does that humor still play today?
Yeah, no, there's, you know, it's fart gags. I mean, Jim says in the book, I think he paid for his weekend place out of fart jokes.
Yeah. Getting this film made, and we touched on talking to the executives.
Yeah.
Michael Eisner, who would go on to run Disney, Jeffrey Katzenberg, who went on to kind of run Hollywood. They were running Paramount at the time.
Right.
And sometimes in the conflict with executives, it gets really acrimonious. You write in the book about the fact that I was kind of surprised at the glowing terms with which you describe these guys.
Yeah, usually I think in books like this, you say, the filmmakers say, well, we made the movie despite the moron studio executives. It was the absolute opposite at Paramount. We came to this place where, and Jeffrey Katzenberg talks about it in the book, where Barry Diller created a culture of, you know, they weren't afraid to fail. Let's experiment, let's do it. I don't know if they would do that, if studios do that today. Every studio turned down Airplane. Michael Eisner heard about it, and then he, you know, he called us up, and, you know, we were at Paramount on Monday morning. So that's what happened then. I don't know if that happens now.
Yeah, they did make some notes that did annoy you guys at one point, and there was a moment where you thought, well, we got this, these other guys who are going to give us more money.
Oh, yeah. Well, what happened, you know, we had this in our mind because Airplane was a spoof of a 1957 black and white movie where it's a prop plane and the same plot, food poisoning, a passenger has to fly down the plane. So we had it in our minds that we wanted to do the movie in black and white and on a prop plane. So we went into, and we heard Michael Eisner was saying no. So we went in and we tell the story in the book that, you know, we gave the whole story, and Eisner absolutely knew how to handle us. He said, well, you made a very convincing argument, and you may turn out to be right, and you may turn out to make this in black and white on a prop plane, and it may go on to be a hit. And we're going, great. And he said, but it won't be at the studio.
Right.
So, so he said, but don't decide now. You know, come back Monday and we'll talk. You know, we'll talk about it. So I think we decided we caved in on our way to the parking lot. but it's part of the thing of Paramount where, you know, these were good people.
Yeah,
We were very lucky.
Yeah. You talked about the fact that you now, you don't give speeches, but you go and you get interviewed, and people want you to come speak and be in front of huge audiences. You get asked all sorts of questions, I imagine. Right. Yeah. Is there a common theme or one question or two that come up over and over again?
There's, you know, the usual things that come up. You know, how did you decide to do Airplane? And, you know, when Jerry and Jim do an interview with me, hopefully they'll say, how do three guys direct a movie? And we all talk at once, and we just gibberish. So, and that always gets a laugh.
Right. But the fact that you still have all this interest, I mean, 40 years later, 40 plus years, that it's funny to my generation. Oh. It's funny to my sons.
Right.
I hope it'll be funny to their kids.
It will.
Did you, when you were making it, did you know that it would be special, that it would stand the test of time looking, or did you even look past the opening weekend?
We didn't, but people ask us, were you surprised, did you know that Airplane would be a hit?
Yeah.
And we said, yeah, we've been doing nothing but for 5 years saying to people, this is going to be a hit, you've got to finance it.
Right.
So when it became a hit, we weren't surprised. But what is surprising is that how it's lasted for 43 years.
Yeah.
And people are still, it's part of the language. That's just wonderful. I love it.
I mean, some of the lines I quote all the time. I mean, surely you can't be joking, just about every day. I picked the wrong week to stop sniffing glue.
Right, yeah.
I mean, there are so many lines that, were they all on the page, or were some of them improvised?
Nothing was improvised. It's just everything was on the page. We just wanted actors to say our lines, and we had the confidence that they would be funny. There was some improvisation on the set, like when they're all shaking the hysterical woman.
Yes.
And it was just supposed to be just shaking her, and then the lady who played the hysterical woman said, well, why don't you slap me? So we did that, and Leslie improvised he slaps the woman, and then somebody says, doctor, you're wanted up front, and he slaps her again. That's wonderful. We didn't write that, but it happened. And then we also improvised, we had the idea on the set that, you know, there'd be a line of people with baseball bats, guns, whips, chains.
Right.
And so
right.
we did that.
And there is a scene where there is a bit of nudity. Did that, I don't remember what the rating was. Was it an R or a PG? Or?
It was PG. It wasn't even PG-13 because PG-13 hadn't been invented yet.
Right.
But, you know, that's why, you know, we like the Marx Brothers, because the Marx Brothers would, you know, take things to just one last level of absurdity. So we thought, you know, even though, you know, we had to go through the steps of casting that woman with the naked breasts, you know, it would still be worth it.
Right.
Yes.
All right, we'll take one more break. When we come back, Airplane, the comedy classic, one of my favorite movies. But what is David's favorite movie of his own wonderful career? We'll ask him in just a moment.
I've got to get out of here.
Calm down. Get a hold of yourself.
Stewardess, please let me handle this.
Calm down. Now get back to your seat. I'll take care of this. Calm down. Get a hold of yourself.
Doctor, you're wanted on the phone.
Another scene from the best comedy ever made, or one of the best. I shouldn't say the best comedy.
I would say the best, but you can.
All right. Airplane. We are back with one of its directors, David Zucker. That's the scene that you were just referencing there with the woman who became hysterical, and the one improvised scene
the end of it was improvised.
Yeah,
the line of people.
So you've made so many wonderful movies. Now, I was telling you off camera that the Naked Gun series I just loved, and seeing my parents laugh at a scene, watching it with them and laughing as I was laughing, gave me such joy. Does that give you joy when you sit in the audience and watch some people laughing? Or are you one of these technicians who's picking apart the scene and thinking, oh, I could have changed that?
It's both. I mean, I love to sit in the audience and watch the audience laugh.
Yeah.
I just, even when Airplane came out, we would go to see the trailer play, and I would go down the aisle to watch the audience from the side, and you'd see people laughing and actually pointing at the screen as though there was anywhere else to look. But it's tremendous. And I also think when I watch some of the movies, oh, I would have done that differently, but I don't beat myself up about it.
Yeah. I loved Airplane. I loved your other films. There must be films that you love both in your own history. If you had to pick amongst your children, what's your favorite? And then who do you like, and who makes you laugh?
Well, I would, you know, my favorite movie that we did was Airplane, really. I mean, because it was the first, and you could never come out of nowhere again,
Yeah.
You know, it just, and then I love the first Naked Gun.
Yes.
Scary Movie 3 was great. Basketball and Top Secret. And those are some of my favorites.
Okay. I can't thank you enough.
Sure.
Thank you so much, David.
This has been fun.
The book, once again, is Surely You Can't Be Serious, The True Story of Airplane. We will continue the conversation with David after we get off the air here on TV on the audio podcast. That drops on Wednesday. We hope you'll join us for that. We'll see you next time.